Welcome to an intimate conversation, just among us, friends and family. First of all, Birshus, Rosh HaYeshiva and Chancellor Dr. Norman Lamb, who always honors us with his presence, who's with us this evening, and the other Rabbeim, members of the faculty, members of the boards of trustees of Yeshiva University, and members of the community, but most important, and members of the faculty, but most important, the students of Yeshiva University. Yeah, that's okay. I certainly, you all know that you all deserve credit, whether you've come from far away through the vicissitudes of Hurricane Irene, or from very close through the vicissitudes of Hurricane Irene, but we've about gotten most of our students to arrive already. And since this is Rosh Chodesh Elul, it's the beginning of the penitential season, we began our studies in the yeshiva, as we always do on Rosh Chodesh, and we begin our academic classes undergraduate tomorrow. It is my great pleasure. My name is Richard Joel. I think I work for most of you. And it's a particular honor to welcome you to the inaugural academic presentation of the Zahava and Moshael Straus Center for Torah and Western Thought. Just a few words of translation before I get out of the way and let the conversation begin. The Zahava and Moshael Straus Center for Torah and Western Thought was made possible through the vision and benefaction of guests, Zahava and Moshael Straus, who I am honored to greet this evening, and they don't want to stand up. Moshael has been a member of the Board of Trustees of Yeshiva University, I think since shortly before he graduated Yeshiva College in 1974. Zahava is an alum of the Benjamin N. Cardozo School of Law of Yeshiva University, and together they have been enormously supportive in the most important ways that count, which are in terms of leadership and in terms of taking ownership of Yeshiva and saying we want to help guide the direction of this incredible institution. A little bit of the history of the Straus Center, which begins tonight. Moshael and Zahava were prepared to be enormously supportive of Yeshiva, but they said that they just don't, they do their share of normative philanthropy, but they said that they want to do something that would be significant. And we went through a fairly serious period of time to talk about what exactly that would be. And I think what was driving Moshael particularly was a focus on Torah Umada, that he saw this institution as the one that was responsible for feeding the world, what I call the tribe of Levi, the people who are the sweet singers of Israel, who are the teachers of Israel, who are the people who take responsibility for preparing the service of Israel, who combine a profound commitment to Torah and Torah values, and knowing that that launches them to explore all of God's other gifts, and the arts and sciences, and culture and commerce, and poetry and prose, and determined to partner with the transcendent and with all people of goodwill to advance civilization. And we say that, and we do that, but sometimes we don't focus on what we mean by that and how we do that. And after lots of conversations and talks with academic advisory committees, we decided that what we really needed was an intellectual center that would focus on Torah and Western thought and the interstitial relationships between Torah and Western thought. The goals was to help Yeshiva University advance our agenda, to work to educate the finest men and women to live integrated lives based on Torah, to help provide Torah observant public intellectuals for the world. And we plan to do that, and you'll see more of it through these type of presentations, but also through academic courses, through the development of courses, through grants and fellowships, through programs both at Yeshiva University and throughout the community to really make headlines out of what it is that we are, what it is that we do, and what it is that we must do. In doing that, we also searched for a director, for an inaugural director, who would embody those values, but more than that, who would restlessly want to promote those values hand in glove with the faculty of Yeshiva University. And in finding Rabbi Dr. Meir Soloveichik, I believe that it's a homecoming of a proud son of Yeshiva who is determined and mission-driven to invest in Yeshiva and to help just provide a glorious platform for you to grow. Rabbi Soloveichik is a graduate of Yeshiva College. He received his ordination at the Rabbi Isaac Elchanan Theological Seminary. He was a star pupil in our Bella and Harry Wexner Kollel Elyon. He went on to earn a PhD at a lesser institution named Princeton in religion. He serves as associate rabbi at Congregation Kehilat Jeshurun in New York, and he has agreed to take on full-time responsibilities leading and guiding the center, assisted by quite a distinguished academic advisory committee. They determined that this year's theme of the Straus Center was to be biblical ideas and American democracy. And we wanted to start it here as the week of orientation, or the 3 days of orientation because of the hurricane, draw to a close, to kind of launch you in a proper way. Dr. Lamb has often talked to me about how we have to highlight Torah Umada and make sure that students go into the academic year thinking about it. This is the first event in a series of great conversations featuring prominent figures in public life who will, in an interview with Rabbi Soloveichik, address questions regarding faith and democracy in an extended conversation. On October 28th, we'll welcome Chief Rabbi Jonathan Sachs of Great Britain in the next conversation. Tonight, we welcome Senator Joe Lieberman. I said earlier that we invited Senator Lieberman because since Yeshiva University cannot be political, we could only have senators who were independent. So it was between Joe Lieberman and Bernie Sanders, and we decided on Joe Lieberman. But the truth is, I needn't give you Senator Lieberman's biography and the role he has played as a civic leader, as a statesman, as a groundbreaking Jew, and as a serious Jew. And we thought it was wonderful, particularly with the publication of his new book, which you will talk about, I'm sure. We thought it was wonderful to have him. But I must tell you, the senator, I'm not going to give you any of the other accolades of Senator Lieberman, except to say that he's a member of the family. His yichus is the following. His son-in-law is Professor Jacob Weiss, who is an extraordinary professor of art history, undergraduate, and is the director of the wonderful Yeshiva University Museum. His daughter, Hani, and son-in-law are graduates, respectively, of Stern College for Women and Yeshiva College. His son-in-law is in the Smicha program, in the rabbinical program, and they are both spending an extended vacation at the Grus Center in Jerusalem, where they're doing a year of Torah study together as they move on in their career. So Joe and Hadassah are truly members of the family. It's my pleasure to introduce them to you and to ask you to give your attention to Rabbi Soloveichik and have a wonderful evening.
Birshus Mori Varabi, Rabbi Dr. Lamb, thank you so much, President Joel, and I want to thank you and Moshael and Zahava for your faith in me and for giving me what I consider the opportunity of a lifetime to be the director of the Zahava and Moshael Straus Center for Torah and Western Thought. The mission of the Straus Center is to bridge our students' immersion in Torah with an engagement at a high level of various academic disciplines to cultivate Jewish thinkers and intellectuals whose ideas can then impact America and the world. Our theme for the year is Jewish Ideas and American Democracy. And we'll be teaching seminars that bring classical Jewish and halachic texts about government into conversation with the foundational texts of American public life, Locke, Burke, Paine, Hamilton, Federalist Papers, de Tocqueville, etc. And in so doing, we will in part ponder the role that religion has played in American public life and consider what unique message Judaism might have for America today. Building on this theme, the Straus Center will also be hosting throughout the year what we call Great Conversations on Religion and Democracy. This is our first such public conversation. I want to thank the Assistant Director for Operations at the Straus Center, Stuart Halpern, for all his help and everything and in helping me to put this together. Thank you, Stu. Without you, none of this would have happened at all. We're honored today by a guest who is the perfect person with which to begin our series of public conversations about America. In 1788, a celebration was held in Philadelphia, celebrating the ratification of the Constitution. As part of the parade in the celebration, Christian clergy and a rabbi walked arm in arm, and Benjamin Rush, a signer of the Declaration of Independence, commented on what he called, quote, a delightful sight. There could not have been a more happy emblem contrived, he said, of that section of the new Constitution, which opens its powers and offices alike, not only to every sect of Christians, but to worthy men of every religion. Today, we welcome one who has not only written a book about a uniquely Jewish idea for an American audience, the gift of rest, rediscovering the beauty of the Sabbath, but we're also welcoming someone whose own life embodied Rush's description of the unique nature of the United States. Or as the greatest theologian of the 20th century, Yogi Berra, put it when he was told that the mayor of Dublin, Ireland was Jewish, the mayor of Dublin, Ireland is Jewish, only in America. Senator Lieberman, welcome to the Straus Center and welcome to Yeshiva University. Why don't we begin by talking about your motivation in writing a book about a fundamental aspect of your faith and how it connects to your own Only in America life story.
Thanks, Rabbi. Oh, there we go. This is, okay. I feel like reciting one of the commandments now that I'm... Anyway, thank you, Rabbi Soloveichik. It's an honor to be with you. Thank you, President Joel, Rabbi Lamb. Thank you for being here. My teacher and muse, Rabbi Menachem Ganak, is here. My cousin, Harold Bernstein, is here. I mean, I could go through the crowd. It's good to be at YU, and I feel very much at home. In some ways, to try to get to your question, I'll just sort of introduce my thoughts through why I'm so proud to be here at Yeshiva University and why I'm so grateful to the Straus family for starting this center. Because after all, we believe, a lot of us in this room, that God gave the Torah to the Jewish people not to study it and sort of keep it under a basket, but to learn from it and take what we learn out into the world to do what popularly, perhaps too conventionally, has come to be known as tikkun olam, but it's really tikkun olam b'malchus shaddai, to improve and better the world under the sovereignty of the, through the sovereignty of the Almighty. In any case, this university uniquely has stood for that ideal of Torah in the world, a learning at a very high level, but then intersecting with the world as it is and trying to make it better. And this Straus Center really creates, in a sense, a new front in that effort, particularly at a time when there is a temptation to pull back in the midst of all the freedom that we have to pull back into a more narrow world. I think Yeshiva University and the Straus Center stand for an important proposition, that our mission really cannot be narrow or parochial, but has to be outreaching. I have been blessed in my life in this extraordinary country to enjoy the blessings of liberty, the blessings of democracy, and to have been elected to a series of offices. And why did I write this book? I wrote the book because Sabbath observance, Shabbat observance, which has been part of my life for most of my life, if you read the book, you'll see that during college, almost according to the script, I left observance. And law school, of course, was a very ungodly place, so I even went further away then. But afterward, came back to it. It's been an increasingly important part of my life. So Shabbat, which begins, after all, with a commandment, is something, a day out of seven, an experience, a part of my life that I have experienced really as a gift, not a commandment. And so I wrote this book, very different than anything I've written before. I didn't realize actually until a couple of weeks ago that this was my seventh book, which obviously was meant to be a book about Shabbat, the seventh day. And it's very different. People know in Connecticut particularly, and perhaps from my 2000 vice presidential campaign, that I observed the Sabbath. I think mostly people in the general society know what I don't do, what we don't do on Shabbat, which is, generally speaking, we don't work unless there's an emergency or some reason to do things that we normally wouldn't do. I don't think they know what we do. And I therefore thought, had this idea of writing this book. Rabbi Ganak, who I study with regularly, once I made the mistake of telling him that I was thinking about writing this book, was a real nudge, a real pest, until I finally agreed to write it. And I'm grateful to him for pushing me to do so. And so what's the purpose of it? The purpose of it for Jews and non-Jews is twofold, really to escort the reader through a typical Shabbat, the 25 hours of Shabbat, to know what we do. Incidentally, I've hoped in doing so, and I've had very good reactions from both non-observant Jews and non-Jews, that people would have a better sense of what this day is for us. It's not just a day of denial. It's not just, though it is in part, a serious day of prayer and learning. It's a day of enormous pleasure. And so I've tried to convey that. And of course, I'm also trying to make a larger point here and trying in my own senatorial way to be Makarov people who read the book, to bring them closer and in, both Jews and non-Jews, to come back to observance, because in this society, particularly the information age, people, every day seems like every other day. There are no separations. Nobody says a hamavdil at any point. And in failing to create separations, I think people lose perspective. One of the fascinating reactions to the book that I've had so far is, and how many of the interviews I've done with the media, people say, do you really turn your BlackBerry and cell phone off on Friday night? And I say, it's actually the hardest thing for me to do as the sun sets on Friday. But once I do it, I feel totally liberated. And there is a lesson in this, which is, among many things, which is that the world can get by without me for 25 hours once a week. This is a very hard lesson for a senator to learn. And if the world really needs me, as I say in the book, the world will find me. So anyway, honestly, I'm hoping not only to be Makarov to Jews to come back step by step to more Shabbat observance, but also really to see if I can convince others, particularly Christians in this country, to come back to some of the Sundays that they experienced in their lives growing up and that they miss very much today.
There's actually a lot of three-day yontifs coming up this week.
Yes, that's my next book.
Yeah. If you can make the case for three-day yontif, Senator, you should be a rabbi, because none of us have been able to sell anybody.
Actually, I was hoping that you would figure out how to reconvene the Sanhedrin so we could go back to one day.
You'd be surprised how many people have asked me that, actually. That is actually one of the missions of the Straus Center for Torah.
That's right.
Get rid of 2 days of yom tov. Exactly. That's what we're all about. The truth is that Shabbos and you are based, this is really an unusual situation. You are a public figure, Senator Joe Lieberman, but making a religious case to the American public, to Jews, but also to Christians. Faith, in other words, is very much part of not just who you are, but of the case that you make to the world. So it would seem that even though, people often compare you and your groundbreaking candidacy for the vice presidency and your whole career to that of John F. Kennedy as the first Catholic president. But the truth is that there are really studies in contrast. Let me just quote an excerpt to you from a 2000 article in a journal of religion. It says as follows. John F. Kennedy set the pre-Lieberman model
for dealing with one's faith while running for office. He built a firewall between his religion and his politics, claiming that his faith was a private matter. But the old way of separating one's religion from one's politics is dead and gone with Joe. When Queen Victoria asked Benjamin Disraeli if he was an Old Testament Jew or a New Testament Jew, an Old Testament person or a New Testament person, he responded, "I am the blank page between the two testaments." Well, says this article, Joe Lieberman is not a blank page. The pages of his life are filled with Hebrew and Yiddish writing. In a campaign appearance, he called the vice president and himself nachschleppers in comparison to their beautiful wives. Lieberman is not campaigning on Shabbat. He's turning down pork ribs in Alabama. If elected, he'll walk to the inauguration on Saturday, which you ended up doing anyway. Sorry about that.
Unfortunately, not for my own inauguration.
Exactly, right. He is the first completely public Jew to run for high office anywhere at any time in Jewish history. So would you agree, Senator, that really what you're offering is a fundamentally different model of faith in public life than JFK?
That's a really fascinating insight, and I'd have to say that it's correct. Of course, part of what happened is that there were 40 years that transpired in between in which a lot happened. It may seem far away, but I think actually the civil rights movement of the 60s was a kind of turning point that led to a more openness toward diversity. I should give some really in credit to President Kennedy, because I was 18 years old that year, and I was very excited by Kennedy's candidacy. Part of it was that he was young, he had a mixture of policies, strong on foreign policy, progressive on domestic, that I resonated to. But there's no question that somewhere not too far beneath the surface in my mind was that this was a Roman Catholic candidate for our highest office, and it was a test of America, whether the country would elect such a member of a minority group who partially it was because I'm sure most of my friends in Stamford, Connecticut were Roman Catholics, but part of it really was wondering whether the country would pass this test. Believe me, I wasn't planning to run for senator or president then, but I there was a way in which I had a feeling inside myself that a Kennedy victory would somehow open doors to me that I did not yet give any specificity to in my own life. And I think his election did do that in many ways. But it is true, as you say that he was going out of his way. He was actually, his family, of course, the Kennedys were quite devout, but they were going out of their way to reassure people that, that there would be a real division between church and state in their own lives. And by the time I ran, by the time we got to 2000 and Al Gore asked me to be his running mate, I'd already been religiously observant, Jewish, and a candidate for public office in Connecticut, and it was just who I was, and I never concealed it in any way. I talked about it whenever people wanted to talk about it. In fact, I felt a certain confidence as I approached 2000 that, based on my experience in Connecticut, that not only was my religious the fact that I was an observant Jew not a problem, it was unusually in this country, and I think this really does go back to the theme that you're dealing with in the Straus Center this year of Jewish ideas and American democracy, that it was quite fundamental to this country that I think that the fact that I was observant of Shabbat and other holidays and other parts of my life was really a bond, a tie. And you're right, I didn't conceal it at all. And I will say two things about the 2000 campaign. One is to repeat something that Al Gore said to me the night that we went to Nashville before he was going to announce my selection the next morning. He said, "I want you to know that I talked to several people about whether America was ready to have a Jewish person on a national ticket. And I was interested to conclude that," and I spoke to Jews and non-Jews, "that the fear of anti-Semitism among Jews was much, much, much greater than the reality of anti-Semitism among Christians. And then I decided that I could choose who I wanted, which was you. The second thing to say, and I'm not relitigating the results of the election in Florida, what I'm about to say. But, you know, politics is like sports in many ways, not just the competition, but it does come down to numbers, to averages, to whatever. The fact is, and I apologize, I don't mean to say this for myself, I'm really saying it for America, but that the ticket on which the first Jewish American was honored to be did get more than 500,000 more votes than the other ticket. And I think that is a magnificent expression of the openness, tolerance, acceptance of the American people, but also that I read it right. I mean, I wouldn't have concealed who I was anyway, but that it didn't hurt me at all in that campaign. Well,
building on that point, you mentioned the vice, that Al Gore said that the Jews were more worried
during the campaign. The Anti-Defamation League sent you a letter which said that, quote, as this campaign unfolds, we urge you to keep in mind that public profession of religious beliefs should not be an elemental part of this or any other political campaign.
Yeah.
I don't think you kept that in mind.
I didn't know. No. This happened.
You chose to ignore
yeah,
that.
I did. Right. I spoke a couple of weeks after I got on the ticket at an African-American church in Detroit. And I spoke about the role of religion in American life. And I went back to the founding. The founding generation of Americans was mostly religious. They were certainly all deists, but they were very learned and committed to the Torah, to the Hebrew Bible, to what they would call the Old Testament. In the founding documents, I'm sure you're learning this from Rabbi Soloveichik, those who are studying this, the references to the Almighty are very Jewish. They're very Hebrew Bible. They're creator, their supreme lawgiver, et cetera. Now I got so wound up with going back to history, I forgot your question.
ADL.
Oh, ADL. So I was speaking at the church in Detroit anyway, and that's, you know, I made a point, which I'll make here again, which is that the First Amendment is a magnificent instrument of human liberty. It promises freedom of religion. It doesn't promise freedom from religion. When you go into the public square, when you are a candidate for public office, you do not lose your First Amendment right to talk about your religion if you want to. You know, nobody's compelling you to. And so, you're right. With all respect to Abe Foxman, I did not listen to ADL's injunction.
Why do you think some Jews think that a fully secular public square is better for the Jews, better for America?
Yeah, well, of course, there's a historic reason for that, which is that over so much of Jewish history in the last couple of thousand years, when religion came into the public square, it often was to the detriment, if not the actual suffering, of Jews. So I understand that. But this is a different place. It is built on a different ethic and a different constitutional system. It's not perfect. There have been times, clearly, of significant anti-Semitism. But it's not really the core of what the country has been about. I mean, if you go back to the founding generation, we all talk now about the Christian evangelicals and their belief in the Bible and their support of Israel. The truth is that these are real powerful currents in American life, probably more openly expressed in their own way than they ever have been before. But go back to read the founding generation of Americans, and there were some very significant Christian Zionists there. So that I think is why Jews have historically been sensitive about this. But I think we ought to have the confidence in this country now to not be rigid and reflexive about it. If people are beginning to do things that threaten our religious freedom or somebody else's, then we ought to speak out against it. But if somebody just wants to, you know, talk about their religion in public, you know, I was about to say God bless them. Anyway, that's the way I feel. I'll just add a parenthesis. It's a topic for another discussion. I believe that we are living in a period of unprecedented warm and growing relations between Judaism and Christianity. It is really consequential. I know enough about history to know that things can change, but I just cite these two historic facts, one within the Catholic Church, Pope John the 23rd, Vatican Council, ecumenical movement, then John Paul II, so changing the liturgy that had was used and as a justification for anti-Semitism, significant historic changes, and then this remarkable booming Christian evangelical movement, Protestant, but you know, it's been my honor to speak to them, and trust me, they know the Torah about it certainly better than most Jews and almost as well as most YU and Stern students.
They don't know the King James here at Yeshiva University.
No.
we don't teach that. Well, a current controversy here in New York City is Mayor Bloomberg's recent decision that New York's clergy should really play no role in the commemoration of the 10th anniversary of September 11th. I mean, given your views, do you think that's the right call?
I respectfully can't say I've really
just
heard.
Just between you and me, Senator.
Yeah, no, it's not. Yeah. We're just having a private conversation. Yeah. I can't say that I've heard Mayor Bloomberg's full explanation of this, but on the surface, I don't get it. I disagree with it. There's a great tradition in this country of turning to religion at significant moments of crisis, of commemoration, right, even of joy, of transition. So I think it would have been better to have clergy people there. You know, about 9/11 occurred on a Tuesday. On the Friday of that week, President Bush flew up here and invited the senators from the tri-state area to fly with him. And we went to Ground Zero, and there was that iconic picture of the president on top of the mound with the firefighter and the strength. And right after that, he came down, right adjacent to that mound, and there was a gathering of some New York political people and a quite diverse group of New York clergymen. And he asked, I believe it was then Cardinal Egan, to offer prayer. And there was no loudspeaker, it was just this assemblage. And it was quite meaningful to everybody there, including the firefighters, a lot of whom had lost colleagues in the World Trade Center. And so I regret that that will not be so at the commemoration.
Let's talk about the flip side then. The case you're making essentially is that faith is an essential part of who a person is. And the notion that he or she can shed that when they enter the public square is to ask them to be not them. So I'm wondering then the following. When you were nominated, so your rabbi in D.C., Rabbi Barry Freundel, and I want to thank both Rabbi Ganak and Rabbi Freundel for their great help in conceiving of this program here tonight. So Rabbi Freundel was interviewed extensively about halacha, about Shabbat, right, about pikuach nefesh, when you can violate the Shabbat. They even asked him why, if you were willing to serve as vice president in national security situations on Shabbat, why you couldn't campaign on Shabbat. He had to explain that there was nobody whose life was in danger if they didn't hear a campaign speech on Shabbat. Now, in your own writing, you allow America into every aspect of your life, every aspect of your own worship. You take them through the shul, from Hashkama Minyan to Havdalah, from Kabbalah Shabbos to Kriyas HaTorah. You even talk about your contrition, if I may say, about attending the Kiddush Club during the Haftorah. Now,
Mea culpa.
It is Rosh Chodesh El, so.
I know, and believe me.
Absolutely.
I understand.
Now, your good friend and colleague, John McCain, seemed in 2008 somewhat skittish about addressing the church that then Senator Obama had attended for many years. But if, as you say, faith is part and parcel of who we are, then shouldn't some of these questions be appropriate? Isn't where you choose to bring your kids or raise your kids an important thing to know about somebody? So how much should one's synagogue or church, one's priest, pastor, or rabbi actually come into someone's candidacy?
Yeah. You just reminded me of one of the funnier stories of that week I was selected about Rabbi Freundel. I was my selection was announced in August. It was 2 days before Tisha B'Av. I was already traveling around the country, but there was a minor machloka, a disagreement in our shul, because Rabbi Freundel was asked to go on the McNeil Lehrer News Hour to explain to the American people what this Orthodox Judaism was all about. And
I would have just sent them a Mishnah Brura.
Exactly.
Figure it all out.
Yeah. I'm sure Lehrer would have understood it.
Absolutely.
So he rushed from the screening to the shul for the Tisha B'Av service, and there were some members of the congregation who noticed that he had makeup on from the TV show, and this created quite a stir in the shul, but he survived it. He survived it. So my answer to you is that it's not unfair to ask if religion is in the public square and a candidate's religion is in the public square. If a candidate's clergyman, rabbi, priest, minister is taking controversial stands, to ask the candidate about it. But I mean, the ultimate answer is, you know, that's not me. I go there for this or that reason. I don't agree with the rabbi or the minister on this or that. But no, you're right. It's a fair question. And look, this whole business of being open about your religion, sometimes people ask me, what role does your religion play in actual decisions you make as a senator? So I start with a disclaimer. Please understand, I don't call my rabbi and ask him how to vote. Right. But I would be misleading you, questioner, if I told you that what I've learned from my religion, what I've learned from my rabbis, is not part of me when I decide what I think is right or wrong and how I vote on a given issue, alongside my secular learning, my experience in life, my reading, etc. But it's part of us, and therefore, if somebody chooses to talk about it, they then invite themselves. I once, during the 2000 campaign, made a terrible mistake. I'm going to do an al-chaytir, but I won't do it too specifically because it's too embarrassing. But somebody asked me something that really bordered on a religious question, and I made the mistake of trying to answer it and gave a bad answer. And then afterward, a rabbi called me and said, I have real rachmanis for you in that. And he said, next time somebody tries that, because the press is always looking, tell them you're running for vice president of the United States, not chief rabbi of the United States. And, you know, there is wisdom to that.
We have to ask you about this because we are here at Yeshiva University.
Yes.
One of the stories that you mentioned in your book is that you actually shared a Dvar Torah from Rav Soloveichik with Sarah Palin. And maybe you could tell us about that.
Right. This is what Rebbetzin Lichtenstein, I think, referred to as the episode of the lonely hockey mom of faith. This is one of the few rooms in America where I could say that and get a laugh, right? Well, life takes you in strange directions. One thing leads to another. I endorsed John McCain in 2008. He was my dear friend. We travel a lot together. I agree with him. We agree with each other on foreign policy, national security, homeland security. Anyway. So then he selects Governor Palin to be his vice presidential running mate, and I meet her, and she's very pleasant, and actually one of the first times I was with her at the convention in Minneapolis, she met with a pro-Israel group, and the campaign asked me if I'd go, and I was quite taken with her very sincere support for Israel. And so when it came time for her to prepare for the vice presidential debate, they asked me if I would happen to be in Philadelphia, where she happened to be for an event, if I'd come up to Philadelphia, that happened to be a Sunday afternoon, and be part of the preparation. And she was just off that day. And I could see that the McCain people were getting really nervous. Not off like that. I know some people think she's always off, but she just wasn't, you know. So anyway, the McCain people were getting very nervous. They called a break. And the Governor Palin stayed in the room with one of her friends from Alaska, and we all went out in the hall, and they're going, oh my God, what are we gonna do? We gotta, it's just, something's happened. So there's a guy named Steve Schmidt, who's one of the campaign managers, and he says, Senator, you gotta go in there and talk to her because you have something in common with her that none of us have. I said, what's that, Steve? You're both religious. Go in there and pray with her. I said, well, I'll go in. So I wasn't gonna pray with her because I hardly knew her, but so, you know, it was like a second date, you know, it was too. So anyway, I go in and say, how are you? And she was very open.
From Soloveichik Torahs for the first date.
Yeah, exactly. So long story short, I'm taking too long on this, but it was a totally unexpected moment. And I said, how are you? And she said, I'm having a bad day. And she was unhappy with the people who were managing her campaign for Senator McCain, blah, blah, blah. And I said to her, you know, I know you're a religious person and you're here for a reason. And I said, I think we talked once before about the Book of Esther. Oh, she loved the book, we talked about it. And then, you know, the whole idea that maybe this is the reason you're here and somebody else might come along to do this if you don't, et cetera. And then I said, you know, I've just been reading a book. I fibbed a little bit there because I had read the book quite a while ago. But it was in my mind, and because I had talked to her about destiny. Anyway, I spoke to her about, as Rav Soloveichik does, about the covenant of fate and the covenant of destiny. Long story short, that the covenant of fate being what we are, the covenant of destiny, what we are to make of ourselves. And she was really quite taken with it, very responsive. And
she did pretty well in the debate too, so.
She did well in the debate, and I give all the credit to Rav Soloveichik.
Excellent. So if you want to succeed in politics, you come to Yeshiva University and study the Torah of Rav Soloveichik.
That's the point. So,
there is something serious though here in the story, which is basically, you're this Jew from Connecticut, right? She's an evangelical Christian from Alaska.
Alaska, right.
And Steve Schmidt basically says, listen, Senator, you're religious and she's religious. Can you get together and do your religious thing?
Yeah, fascinating, right? Because the whole group we were with, all the McCain campaign aides, there's probably 8 or 10 people there. I think there was one guy who's Jewish, not very observant at all. The rest of them are Christian, and Schmidt is Christian, but this was his vision of a kesher that Governor Palin and I had, and in fact, he was right.
So that's my meaning. In your book or in other things you speak about, you talk about sharing Divrei Torah from Rav Soloveichik with Sarah Palin, or, you know, giving an art scroll chumash to Senator Sam Brownback, now Governor Sam Brownback, a Catholic, and talking to him about different explanations in the chumash, right? And you see that almost even more than you say, you don't talk as much about sharing Divrei Torah with the non-observant Jewish senators. And so I'm wondering, have we reached a point in America, right, you don't see sharing Rav Soloveichik Torah with, I don't know, Barbara Boxer or something like that. Maybe next week. But the
could be. Maybe I was going to what I thought would be the more receptive audience.
Right, well, that's my point. Exactly right. In other words, so if we reached a point in America where, on a certain level, you as a traditional religious Jew, believing in obligation, tradition, etc., do we have something in common with traditional Roman Catholics or evangelicals or Mormons that we might not have with less traditional Jews?
Well, certainly at one level we do. One level that includes a lot of different parts. There's obviously a basic part of the theology that is quite different.
Of course.
But in terms of, particularly with the Christian evangelicals, the belief that the Torah is the truth is very profound, and that's a real connection. With Catholics, a lot of it has to do with the place of really ritual and tradition. You know, I don't want to tell another story, but basically I found throughout my career in Connecticut that there has been, as I repeat, great respect and a kind of feeling of a bond because I was both religiously observant and involved and open about it. So at one level, there is, between people who are religious, a bond across religious lines. And this goes back to what I said before. This is a whole new era for that to happen. I don't want anybody to think I'm naive here, but we are at a different stage, I repeat, in the history of Christian-Jewish relations. This is unprecedented at this moment, ever. It's never happened before like this. Now, what becomes of it, we will see. But it's part of why I feel such comfort in these discussions, and I'm not alone. I mean, I could go to other specifics. Catholics and Christian evangelicals believe in religious education for their children. They believe in day schools. Guess what they're worried about? Whether their families can afford tuition to send their kids to religious schools. Does this sound familiar?
You actually joined Speaker Boehner in saving the voucher program for poor children in D.C.
In Washington.
Do you think that there is a potential for this to be... I mean, I was struck by the fact that, I mean, we have many people, including the president. Clearly, their success in their life is linked to the fact that they were sent to a quality school.
Right.
And here you see much of the establishment in D.C., which seemed to not care about the educational needs of poor African-American children in D.C. Do you think this can become, as it were, the next great civil rights movement, uniting members of traditional faiths in America?
Well, there's no question in my mind that the frontier of the civil rights movement in America today is elementary and secondary education. Because in our country, there is profound inequality in access to a good education based on income, and often income correlates to race or nationality in the case of Hispanics. It happens that the Catholic schools and a lot of the Christian evangelical schools offer education at a relatively low cost to low-income children. But there is a potential for an alliance there. Part of the problem is that the timing is not so good, because you may have heard we have a significant debt in our federal government. I know you're very focused on your work here.
We only learn Torah here.
Right. So it's a hard time to come up with a big new spending program. But I tell you, I think there's a growing impatience, I don't want to get into this in depth, but you asked me, with the role of the teachers' unions in stopping reforms in the public schools. And I think insofar as there's a reaction to that, it may, look, the public schools always will and always should educate most of our children. That's the ladder up in American society. But the whole idea that we're gonna tell poor children, often minority children, that they gotta go to a bad public school because we believe in this ideal, even though most of the people advocating that position would not keep their children in that public school, and therefore we won't help them go to a better private or religious school, is just nonsense. And I think it's beginning to change. There are the beginnings of some alliances across faith lines in pursuit of programs like this.
I know, Senator, that you have to go soon because you have to get to the your shalom bias, you told me, with Mrs. Lieberman. It's dependent on you making the last shuttle out. There are two specific things I wanted to ask.
Yes.
Well, one is, you mentioned at the end of your book, you speak about what we say in Havdalah, in the Havdalah ceremony, we speak of God separating between the Jews and the nations. And you note, I believe correctly, that this is not meant as a negative statement about the nations of the world. That's certainly true. I do wonder, do you think there's any tension between American universalism and the foundation of Jewish theology, which is chosenness? I mean, you do say in the Yom Tov Kiddush, Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Am, V'Rom Banu Mikol Lashon, you have elevated us above and sanctified us. So do you feel any tension at all? I mean, much of the book and your career is about, well, we can have everything here. Is there any tension between the American idea and the Jewish notion of chosenness, do you think?
Well, for me, there's not, because, of course, I believe that B'nai Israel, the children of Israel, nation of Israel, was chosen to carry out a universal mission. In fact, the Declaration of Independence, the first American document, adopts that universal mission and derives it from our vision of creation. I mean, it says right there that they're forming the government to secure the rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, which are the endowment of our Creator to every one of us. Now, obviously, some people may feel that it's contrary to American universalism, but I tell you, there's another, and I'm trying to make this point in the section about Havdalah, and I don't think this is inconsistent with American universalism either. Part of what our religion tells us, it's in, you know, the Ten Commandments. Shabbat observance comes from the fourth, but the others, as everybody has said over the years, are not suggestions, they're commandments. Don't steal, don't commit adultery, don't, and do observe Shabbat. Distinctions are made, and this is the way it is in a society of law. One of the things that distinguishes America that we try to bring throughout the world is the rule of law. I mean, this is a very Jewish notion. And the rule of law is created to encode rights and wrongs. And it's quite different from a kind of, sometimes still, but and certainly not so long ago, a kind of mushy notion that everything is okay. If it feels good, it's okay. Whatever you want to do, whatever you want to be. Sometimes some things are wrong, and law has to condemn them.
You, when the history of your life is written, and the how you figured in American history and in Jewish history, I mean, there is certainly something that's historic, leaving the whole Jewish part of this aside, and that is the fact that, I mean, I'm a student of American politics. I don't know of any other case in American history where the vice presidential candidate of one party 8 years later was speaking at the convention of another national party endorsing its candidate. I mean, you have your Zell Miller, you know, coming giving their stemwinders, but that's not the same. So what do you think that part of your life says about the history of the Democratic Party in America when it's written, and the history of the Jewish relationship to the Democratic Party?
Oh, now that's a topic for a long speech.
We have plenty
of time. So I never would have predicted in my wildest imagination that I would end up speaking at a Republican National Convention. So how did it happen? Well, it happened for a couple of reasons. The first is that I lost the Democratic nomination to be senator from Connecticut in 2006 over my position on the Iraq War. There was a larger question there, which you have cleverly encouraged me to get to, and I'll just touch it lightly, which is to he's giving me a little partisan opportunity here, from his point of view. All right, no.
I'm a political cipher.
If I may quote, and Chris, it seems appropriate here, Ronald Reagan, I didn't leave the Democratic Party. The Democratic Party left me. Which is to say, more than in a personal sense, that not just over Iraq, because that was an understood and difficult decision for many people, two things about it. One, but the most important thing was that the Democratic Party that I grew with, Truman was a hero in my family growing up. Truman. And not just because he recognized Israel quickly, but of course that was a big part of it, but he represented strength and support of freedom in the world, strong America, strong defense. Kennedy was the figure who really motivated me to get into public life. And remember the inaugural address, you know, we're going to pay any price, accept any burden to assure the survival and sustenance of liberty. So the Democratic Party, Scoop Jackson is another one, Democratic Party represented this combination of strong in the world and national defense, more progressive here at home. And it stopped being the former. I'm afraid it may still have stopped. So that was part of it. I became an independent. And then, McCain was my friend. And also, I'll be very open here, I'll not surprise anybody, I was not exactly a popular figure in the Democratic Party in 2008. I will say that after I endorsed McCain, somebody in the press asked me, in McCain's presence, and I know he has a good sense of humor, so They said, can you explain why you endorse Senator McCain? I said, it's very simple. He's the only candidate for president this year who asked for my endorsement. But of course, it was more than that. It was both that history of the Democratic Party and the fact, coincidentally, and this is a strange combination of events, that this man happened to be my friend. And of course, I just thought by his greater experience that he was better prepared than any of the Democratic candidates to be the president at that time. So, you know, life is full of surprises, and that was one of them.
One final question. I know your driver is very worried.
I want to inform you, in case you don't know, that as you asked this question, that he is armed.
So very quickly, Senator.
That's okay.
This is student orientation here at Yeshiva. And here in this audience are many students, deeply religious students, who are also interested in public affairs and perhaps in a career in public service. The fact is that public service has another name, and that's called politics.
Right.
And the question I want to ask is, does the lure of the political spotlight embody a greater threat than most professions to integrity, whether it's moral integrity or religious integrity? What advice would you give those who seek a career in the political realm, especially religious students?
Well, this is probably counterintuitive now, because politicians are not in high regard in our country, and there's good reason for that, because of the way the body politic is behaving, partisanship, squabbling, sort of being more concerned about the fight that they're in with each other, we're in with each other, than what the public interest is. But one of the great things President Kennedy did for my generation was to make politics really seem like a noble calling. And of course, I believe it is. I believe it's a field in which you can really get things done. It's not easy. We're a complicated big society. Negotiating in a legislative context is complicated. But you know, as I look back at my career, to have had the chance to be in some of the places I've been in, I'm thinking about the commemoration of 9/11 coming up. I had the opportunity to write with others some of the most significant legislation post 9/11 to secure our country from the threat of Islamist terrorism. So there's great opportunity, and I would urge you to think about it, not just to be in politics, although politics really is, go back to Aristotle, if not earlier, and Jewish sources, it is a noble profession. It is one way to take the Torah out into the world in a most universal sense of that. And you don't have to be an elected official or a politician. To be a member of the civil service, if I may put it that way, to work in healthcare, public health, or go into the military, or be a diplomat, or work in environmental protection, it's enormously constructive and important and valuable. And in a lot of other countries, not so enough in our country, in Europe and Japan, to be a civil servant is one of the most honored positions you can have in those societies, and it ought to be so in our case. And now a final word I want to say about this to the students here, and perhaps if nothing else, my life and career send this message to you as religiously observant Jews, but I hope it sends it to other people who are strong in their faith. Incidentally, I'm going to digress just to say, as I watch Mitt Romney and John Huntsman running for president of the Republican Party, I'm not about to make another endorsement, but one thing that worries me, and I really want to call on everybody here and everybody who's Jewish, because we've had this history, I'm afraid that one of the remaining acceptable religious bigotries is against Mormons. And we particularly, wherever we are, in settings small and large, public and private, should, whatever you think about Governor Romney or Governor Huntsman, don't be silent in the face of that. It's an outrage, really, and un-American. But what I want to say to the students is, based on my experience, my life, in this country, at this moment, and I believe throughout your lives, you will never have to choose between living a Torah-observant life, following halakha, and your secular professional career ambitions, no matter how high or what they are. I must say that when I was younger, I don't know that I could have said that, but this society has really opened up and changed. And so whatever you do, and particularly if you decide to go into politics or public service, do it with the confidence that the system will respect your observance and your coworkers will respect it as well. So I end with humor, because Rabbi Soloveichik has a great sense of humor. One of the stories I tell, one of the things I find about my Shabbat observance is sometimes the Christians I spend a lot of time with are actually jealous of it. And my former colleague from Connecticut, Senator Chris Dodd, once said, he actually started with a joke at a roast of me. He said that he thought he could reveal that, he said, you know, I think it's time enough. I can tell you that Joe Lieberman was actually raised not as an Orthodox Jew, but as a Baptist. And then he got into politics, and there were so many events on Friday night or Saturday, he decided to become an Orthodox Jew. And then Dodd closed this little riff by saying, you know, I'm thinking seriously about converting, but only for the weekends. Thank you very much.
Thank you.